This right here in my hands is an 8-core CPU that's not from Intel and not from AMD. And it's actually quite interesting to the point where this is become of existence because of so many twists and turns that has happened in the history of the company who did a joint venture. And that is VIA Technologies, which is a Taiwan-based semiconductor group that teamed up with the Shanghai government back in 2013 to start making their own x86 processors. Now we'll get onto the rabbit hole a bit later, because this CPU is so weird that when I got it shipped, it came with an adapter that was typical of one that you would plug into a laptop. However, since it has an I/O shield, it's essentially made for a standard ATX desktop case, and it accepts DDR4 SODIMM. So the actual design itself on the motherboard is quite bizarre. Now for the chip itself, they're using what's called a BGA design, that is ball grid array, and that is that the CPU is soldered to the motherboard. Now that being said, let's take a deep dive into the CPU, its performance, and the history right after this message from today's video sponsor. This video is sponsored by Filmora. Now Filmora is a straightforward, extremely beginner-friendly video editing software. There are actually two versions, Filmora 9, which is the one that I've been using over the last week, and you can try this completely free using the link below. Or there's Filmora Pro. Now, if you like the software and you think it's the right editing package for you, then there is the option to purchase the software with a one-time fee only of $60. That is right, if you are tired of paying monthly fees to a company that has weird crashes and really hasn't changed their software for the past 10 years, then Filmora is definitely an option worth considering. Filmora 9 is also really lag-free when it comes to scrubbing, editing, and snapping footage and cutting it together. It's extremely easy, and it's also got a very beginner-friendly learning curve. So if you want to get into editing videos for free, or if you want to try a different software that will give you a very professional look, then you can use the link below. It's free, or it's only going to be a one-time fee of $60 if you like it. Links below. Let's get back to the video. This here is the Jiaoxian Kaixian KX-U6780A, and it's a 16-nanometer TSMC manufactured CPU, 8 cores, 8 threads, so it doesn't carry the multi-threading abilities that Intel and AMD 8 cores would carry, where they have 8 cores, 16 threads. It also doesn't carry instruction sets past AVX, and that it doesn't have AVX2. So in the results I'm about to show you, especially in Cinebench R20, it will fall quite a bit behind due to the fact that not only is the CPU clocked its 8 cores, 8 threads to 2.7 gigahertz all core, but it also can't enable that AVX2 instruction set to get better results in this benchmark. Now this CPU adapter and motherboard combo did not come cheap. It cost me around $800 in total, and then I had to pay an extra $60 shipping. So $860 for a motherboard, a BGA soldered chip, and no RAM, and some 96 watt adapter. Also, who could forget the noisy CPU cooler too? Though if you thought that was weird, then it only gets weirder, where in this case, I had to hook up 2 power supplies. It comes included with a standard AC adapter type power supply, which you need to power the motherboard, and that also powers the CPU, where they've got a 4-pin CPU power connector that doesn't really do anything. Then if you want to hook up a graphics card and an SSD, for example, then you're going to need a separate power supply, and you're going to need to short that power supply from 2 pins from the 24-pin just to power your graphics card and your SSD, for example. So it was quite difficult to get this running up and normal and compare it to traditional processors from Intel and AMD. And also on top of that, I'm not going to go easy on this CPU. We're not holding back. We're going to be using an RTX 2080 Ti and throwing up some of the results here for you. You can see in productivity benchmarks, Cinebench R20, we are just in a lower league. Like if basically Intel and AMD are in the major league, this would be in the garbage tier league. Moving over to 7-Zip showed a similar result with compression and decompression numbers, and then over to Geekbench showed that that single thread performance and also that multi-threaded performance does leave a lot to be desired. Though, stepping things over now to gaming benchmarks, you guys wanna see, can you game on a CPU not from Intel and AMD? And the answer is surprisingly yes, you can, although the results of course are quite low. Shadow of the Tomb Raider, 1080p, 42 average FPS, GTA 5, 53 average FPS. Resident Evil 3, 75 average FPS. Fortnite, 96 average FPS. And then the last benchmark was Warzone, where we got 69 average FPS. So, of course, using the SoDim memory isn't the best configuration, and in fact, if they could get the clock speeds a lot higher, say in the 4 GHz region, then you'd see a lot better FPS, I'm sure. But that being said, going up against the hard hitters Intel and AMD was never going to be easy. And the fact that this company has done this within 7 years and they're able to actually run an x86 processor is quite impressive in its own. And in fact, this is where things get really weird with why this company is even able to exist. In a crazy turn of events and a weird twist of fate, the company VIA Technologies, and now in the joint venture Zhao Xin, ended up with a valid x86 license.
Bata Bata is the name of the dance we do down Johannesburg way.
Cyrix was first founded in 1988 in Texas, and they never originally had an x86 license. They just happened to reverse engineer an Intel chip and then design what was known as an X87 processor. And in this time, Intel tried to take them to court, and it actually ended up backfiring on them, where they weren't found guilty of any infringements on patents, where Cyrix counterfiled an antitrust claim, which was then settled out of court for $12 million, which from this agreement, Cyrix also managed to gain access to some of Intel's patents. And later on, they both entered into a cross-licensing agreement, which gave them access to each other's patents. So this was very important for Cyrix in order to make x86 processors. But through the chain of events, in 1997, Cyrix was then acquired by a company called National Semiconductor, and then later on, they sold that to VIA. So VIA ended up owning Cyrix in the end, and with that, they then gained access to that ever so crucial x86 license. So as VIA now had the x86 licensing, they found themselves needing a better CPU architecture to work from the ground up on. And this is where Centaur came into the mix. In 1995, this was founded and funded by a company called IDT. And their goal was to make cheaper Intel x86 processors, also be more power efficient. And this company was also later acquired via VIA, which of course over the years has been revised and updated, and which is now known as the VIA Nano, which I believe is the core architecture in today's CPU from Zhao Xin. But with that aside, here's where the rabbit hole starts to go very deep, and it starts to have a lot of different tunnels twisting out from it that is honestly very confusing, and that is the x86 licensing agreement itself. Back in 2003, there was a 10-year agreement made which extended to April 2013 with VIA Technologies and Intel. However, in this time frame between 2003 and 2013, AMD opened a lawsuit against Intel for anti-competitive practices, which did see in 2009 a settlement made for $1.25 billion for AMD in rewards for damages that Intel caused them for their anti-competitive business practices. Though, one thing that came out of this was also in 2010, October 29th, a consent decree between Intel and the FTC. Digging deeper into this decree showed that there was some more orders issued from the FTC regarding the Intel and VIA agreements. And that is that this 10-year agreement was now essentially a 15-year agreement. But also on top of that, until October 29th, 2020 this year, VIA is allowed to sell their own x86 CPUs. However, what I don't know is after this date, is VIA going to enter into another agreement with Intel, and what's going to happen going forward? So what we can see from that research is that VIA is able to make x86 processors, and they're doing it in a weird form of a joint venture established in 2013, where I'm guessing VIA owns the majority of that joint venture, which then enables them to use that x86 license. Though in terms of these CPUs, you can currently only buy them within China themselves. They are what's known as a CDM, or China Domestic Market product. And that essentially means is that you won't find these on the shelves of retailers in any other part of the world. However, the goals, in my opinion, of Zhao Xin are very clear cut. And that is two reasons why this company exists and why going forward, I see them to continually improve their CPU design and become a big player, at least within China itself. And the biggest reason for this is the Chinese government wants to develop supercomputers, and in 2015, the United States blocked NVIDIA, AMD, and Intel specifically from selling them higher-powered chips in use of supercomputers. The second reason is China also has their 2025 initiative, whereby this year they want all the products consumed domestically to be made within China. This is where we're now going to stop and talk about what ifs going forward. Apparently their next architecture is lined up on 7nm, and that's coming very soon. That is the KX7000 series, where the CPU we featured today was the KX6000 series. And that is apparently going to support higher clock speeds, have AVX2, AVX512, and also support DDR5 and PCIe 4.0, where currently this CPU can only support DDR4 SODIMM and PCIe 3.0. Though what about fast forwarding 5 years? Is Jiaoxin going to become a major competitor in the likes against AMD and Intel? And it's a very big possibility. And the reason for that is if the company is funded by the Chinese government, then that does mean one thing. They're essentially being funded by the richest entity in the world with trillions of dollars up their sleeve. So in terms of R&D, this company definitely has access to a lot of it. But in terms of implementation and having the genius to design a CPU x86 architecture that can compete with AMD and Intel in 2020 is another thing altogether. You can't just get the lads around for a Saturday night pizza and games and spin up something that's going to compete with the likes of Intel and AMD that easily. It requires a team of brilliant engineers, as witnessed by the Centaur CEO, saying that they're essentially a more effective company with a team of 60 versus Cyrix's team of 400. So in the next 5 years, are we going to see a CPU that will compete with the likes of the two big guys already in the game? And I don't know, I'm not entirely sure. I'd love to read your thoughts and opinions in the comments section below, because one thing I definitely know in the history of buying products from China is that you can get some really good stuff, but on the other side of the fence, you can also get some stuff that just quite simply doesn't work. And the fate of Jiaoxin is basically in the hands of Jiaoxin. What they do next, I'm sure the world will start to be watching. It's very interesting and it's very cool to see a new player in the game, but there's a big hill to still climb for this company, especially for a chip that costs $800 and doesn't perform anywhere near the likes of AMD or Intel. And with that aside, I hope you guys enjoyed today's video. If you did, then be sure to hit that like button for us. Also, if you want to read more about this topic, then I'll put some links in the description below for you. But also, another YouTuber in the tech scene, Gamers Nexus, made a big video on this CPU company as well. I'll put the link for that video up here if you wish to see it. Also, lastly, a big thanks to Marco, who you guys will probably see in the comments if you hang around here enough. And thanks for organizing all this. It was a cool experience. I hope you guys enjoyed today's video. Another thing I will say is that when I booted this up too, I had budgeted a lot more time for doing this testing because I thought I would have ran into a lot more problems, and I actually didn't run into any problems. Sure, it was a very janky experience to get this whole setup working, but once it worked, the Windows install and the games all worked fine. The testing all worked fine. I didn't get one crash, which was surprisingly good. Another thing is too, I did notice an odd anomaly in the BIOS where it said I had 16 gigabytes of RAM, and I did, but only one of the sticks was showing up, and it looked like it was misreporting a different slot on that motherboard. So interesting to see a whole different motherboard from BioSoft, as well as a different CPU. And with that aside, if you guys have stayed this far and you're enjoying the content and you're not yet subscribed, you may wish to hit that sub button, ring that bell, and I'll catch you in another tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.